everybody. I'm Dr. Chris Armstrong, Director of the Melbourne ME CFS Collaboration, supported by Open Medicine Foundation Australia. And I wanted to introduce to you today Dr. David Fineberg. David is a GP who actually has begun a PhD within our group here in the Melbourne ME CFS Collaboration here at the University of Melbourne. And he's going to be doing a couple of projects working to study patients and working towards a clinical trial. And first, I just wanted to introduce him and why he was interested in working with ME-CFS. So thank you very much, David. Would you like to tell everybody how you got involved with this field?
Yes, so thank you very much for introducing me, Chris. So I am a GP. I moved into research about a year ago, but my journey with ME-CFS started many, many years ago. And I think my first interaction with someone with ME-CFS was actually when we were GP trainees. So we were just out of medical school. We'd been practicing for 4 or 5 years by this point, and we were training to be fully fledged GPs. One of my colleagues at the time, who was second semester in, he'd only been doing it six months, had been diagnosed with ME-CFS. And this was my first interaction with someone just like me, just at where I was in training, in life, in everything. And I watched this guy who was brilliant. As I think you will understand, Chris, most people diagnosed with ME-CFS have this brilliance to them. And he was so switched on. He was so smart. His clinical skills were amazing. But he would manage to do 4 hours of a day, you know, just consulting patients, same pace as me. And then he would go and sit in his car and sleep. And it was so counterintuitive to work so hard and then to actually sleep in his car that it really highlighted how much of an impact this illness has. And I think it really held him back. I think it held him back from his dreams and where he wanted to be. And I always think about him, and I think about people who have touched my life with this condition. One of my very close friends was diagnosed very recently with a post-viral fatigue syndrome. And we used to go for walks around the botanical garden at lunch. He would work full days. We'd jog if we could. And just watching the effect on his life after this has just been brutal and been a really strong motivator for me to get into research and try and find something. And I think as time went on, I went from seeing these people and then trying to help these people, but there wasn't a lot out there. There weren't options. There weren't not good options anyway for treatment. And then I thought, you know what, if I can't find people, if I can't find treatments, I'm gonna make them myself. And that's when I found Chris.
Well, we're very appreciative. I mean, it's very honourable that you have such a great mindset towards helping people. Very appreciative that you're choosing to use your time to help ME-CFS patients, and really excited to see what you have to do within your PhD. So first of all, maybe we should talk about your first project, which is looking to trial food on ME-CFS patients.
Yeah, so the first project that we're doing is assessing people's response to food. Now, there have been a few patient-derived studies or questionnaires that have shown food has a significant impact on PEM, or basically worsening symptoms. And we find that no food is terrible, but actual food can sometimes crash people. And I think when you ask people, nearly everyone will have a story of this. And what we hope to do is to try and quantify it, try and measure it. I think that the actual dream, if we could find something big here, would be to use this as a diagnostic test. But I think what we try to do is just find something to test methods, to test all these fantastic physiological tests, all these functional tests. We're using special computer programs to test brain function and cognition. We're using special cameras to test the pupillary response, or the way our eye responds to light. Grip strength and a whole lot of metabolomic and proteomic studies. We've got lots and lots of different things that we're hoping to do here to test response and hopefully use that same platform and that method for later clinical trials, later trials where we're using medicines to test a response and see where people get to.
Yeah,
that's the first experiment.
I think it's the first good little project to do. I don't know, it's going to be a significant study, but the first good one to trial a few of these different types of functional measures, because obviously we know in this field there's a dearth of objective measures, and so capturing a few of these that can perhaps monitor a patient experience, something as subtle as a meal, seeing if we can identify a few that are sensitive enough to detect changes within that group, I think would be really, really helpful, at least pushing to see which ones will be used in future trials. So I really think that one's excellent. And so for your next trial, I think the next large project as a part of your PhD will be one working on saline, right? So maybe I thought it'd be great if you could take us through, I guess, why you're interested in initially trialing saline, and then we can talk a little bit more about the details of that project.
So saline, as an idea, as a treatment, is very it's novel, but it's also been around for a very long time. The studies go back 20 years, even longer, really to 1997 and the late 90s, where people were using saline. It's basically saline as an infusion. You go, you get a needle in your arm, a drip, and a liter of fluid with salt in it, which, as we know, salt makes a good impact for a lot of people with ME/CFS, gets put into your body very quickly. And that has all these sorts of effects, but quite often improves people temporarily, but it improves them. Now, that improvement can last for days, but it can be up to weeks. And, well, not weeks, but probably in under 2 weeks. What we want to try and do is establish a therapy, something that's useful that we can then say, hey, look, is it saline that's doing it? Is it salt? Is it water? Is it volume, just increasing your blood volume? Or is it the electrolyte imbalance and changes that are doing it? So we're not just going to use saline. We're going to use a whole lot of other different infusions to try and see, is it the osmolarity or the electrolyte composition change that makes the improvement, or is it just saline or just volume? But what we hope to really do is find something that we can use as a rescue treatment, a short-term, quick therapy that's going to help people. And it's not going to be something that'll be sustainable. You won't be able to go every 2 weeks and get this, but it might be a good rescue treatment. And I think we're needing something that's got evidence behind it. So hoping to enroll quite a few people for this one to get some very robust and strong evidence there.
Yeah, that sounds really excellent. I think a key feature of saline, right, is that rapid response that we see as a treatment with the ME/CFS, which a lot of these low dose treatments that are required can often take quite a long time for us to see an impact of an effect. So I think one of the things that I'm really excited to see is that sort of rapid improvement, and then what that looks like with the physiological measures that you're also taking before and after. Mm-hmm. And also I think the key thing from the saline trial, because of that rapid improvement, you know, you can get one dose and see that change, which means we can trial multiple different things on the same people, right? So can you take us through the trial design so that people can hear that?
Yeah, so what we plan to do is using a placebo control, so a treatment where there's no actual treatment involved. So that'll be just a very short term. It'll be a drip, but it won't be a lot of fluid. We're going to use saline. We're going to use dextrose. We're going to use a Hartmann solution, so different compositions. But every single person will get every different option there. And we'll trial it every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks. People will come in for their next infusion in the series, which will be all random. So we don't know, or the person won't know exactly what treatment they're getting that day. And we'll be able to measure them before, after, and in between with a couple of home measure studies. And that will be done often through computer programs that will be sent to them, questionnaires and little microblood samples. So we'll be taking a few samples, measuring urine samples, but every 2 weeks or 2.5 weeks, a different treatment over 4 weeks, over four sessions will be the plan there. It's going to take a while. We're hoping to enroll quite a few people. So it's going to take a long time for everyone to get through. But I think we're going to have great results when we get there.
Yeah, I think that's particularly exciting. Like the idea that you have multiple treatments and all different options being tried on the same individuals. I think a key part of that might be to identify maybe you do see different types of or different people within that cohort with different responses to the different types of saline. So you might be looking for an improved response with something like, you know, the dextrose and the saline rather than just pure saline by itself, or the opposite be true. So I'm definitely interested to see that outcome, I think. And so I guess the recruitment part of this, when do we think we'd be looking to start beginning recruitment for, I guess, this saline project?
Yeah, so the saline project will probably take place after the meal challenge or concurrent. We're not entirely sure. Given how long it's going to take, we project about a year of treatment. I think that's how it's going to run. It's going to be about a year, but I think recruitment is going to come either from referrals. So we're going to advertise through the Open Medicine Foundation, but also referred from people's GPs and then from my own clinic that I'm hoping to set up soon, focusing on ME/CFS. So trying to recruit from within people that we know, people that are interested in trials, will be able to get in touch with us through the University of Melbourne or through our clinics, and then start. And I don't think we're planning to recruit soon. It's we have to go through a process of rigorous ethical testing to make sure that the experiment design is perfect and that there's no concerns or questions, and that if this needs to be picked up by someone else, if this needs to be paused and restarted, the methodology is so rigorous that anyone can pick it up and take off where I left off. So we need to have that set up, and that's standard for every experiment, but that process takes time. I'm not sure exactly how long. I don't think it'll be in under 6 months, but it'll probably be in around 6 months or so at, I think, at the longest. Do you think, Chris, that sounds about right? Six months?
I think that's right. I think we could maybe look project at the end of this year or start of next
Yeah.
year to begin our trial. I mean, this is it's still in the early phase of development of the protocol and going through ethics or going through the ethics submission process at the moment. So it's hard to know exactly. I think some aspects to this trial are interesting. I think it's relatively low risk, right, with the saline,
Yeah.
but then the actual layout of the trial might be a little bit different. So we'll determine because everyone's getting the same treatments and but in randomized order. So perhaps something like that might be more tricky. We'll have to work out. We'll have to wait and see. But very excited for the potential of these projects. I think some of the key things that are really exciting about the idea of saline, as you mentioned, has been reported by a lot of patients to be successful in helping them or improving symptoms. So it's not only just looking to see what can help them, but then, we get to measure things that as to what's changing biologically and physiologically as while they're improving. What are some of the markers and why is it helping them? Kind of understanding that is going to be a key part of this project. And at the same time, we have like a long history of other treatments trialed within ME/CFS and trials that have happened where the delivery of the treatment has gone along with a saline infusion, right? And then the placebo has also had that saline without that treatment, and placebo has been quite large and of an improvement within that group, which has
Unfortunately, confounded a lot, hasn't it?
has confounded a lot, right? But better understanding that impact of saline, I think, would do us all a favor, I think, going forward with research in this field, and could set up for better trials into infusion-based studies in the future, right? Great. Well, thank you very much, David. Really appreciate everyone listening, and hopefully we kind of got people interested in what we're doing, and we'll be back with some more of these type of interviews in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much.